right, guys. The moment you've all been waiting for. Thank you all for joining us again. As you know, we do this business lecture series every semester, and every semester I try to get cooler people than the last semester. I think I may have succeeded this time. We'll see. We'll see. So as you all know, our entrepreneur program here at GCC is really growing. We're doing tremendous things, and there's so many great things on the horizon. If you are not aware, we actually have an entrepreneur club here on campus, and we meet every Thursday at 3 p.m. in the Sandbox Lab. It's 3 to 4 p.m. If you are part of the club, we do field trips. If you want to be involved with this awesome stuff that's going on, in addition, we're talking about business, and we're talking about how to start your business, and we're really starting things like the networking event that you saw before this, and also a maker space, so if you have an idea, you can go out and make it happen. That's what we're doing here on campus. So if you ever dreamed about owning your own business, now is the perfect time to get involved. And with that, I'm going to invite Arav up. She's our club president, and I'd like her to talk a little bit more about it.
Hi, everyone. Welcome. Thanks for coming out. As she mentioned, we have a club here called Lean In for Entrepreneurs, or Life Club for short, which I started after reading a book called Lean In for Graduates by Sheryl Sandberg. She's the CEO of Facebook. She wrote a really cool book. That's what inspired me to start it. So I brought it here to campus. It's the third semester that we've been holding meetings, which our meetings consist mostly of their leadership development activities. We do a lot of entrepreneurial mindset training and actual resources for students with businesses or aspiring entrepreneurs and existing entrepreneurs with an advisor like Marisa and the rest of our faculty that are involved. Absolutely everything is possible. Unfortunately, it's my last semester here. So I want to invite all of you to join the club, but also encourage you to run for cabinet if this is something you're interested in. On the school website, under clubs and organizations, you'll find my contact information. So if you're, whether you want to join or actually run for a cabinet, just shoot me an email and we'll talk about making it all happen. Okay, thanks for your attention. I hope you enjoy the rest of the afternoon. Thanks.
All right, thank you. And I would like to invite anyone standing to please come in. We still have some seats. I don't know how much longer they will be open, as this usually is a full house, standing room only. And without further ado, I'm going to introduce you to our beautiful panel here. Today we are talking entrepreneurship, leveraging and branding the skateboard culture. As you know, skateboarding has become huge. And from what I hear, it is likely to be an event at the Olympics coming up shortly, so that's pretty exciting, especially if we get the Olympics in 2024, which LA may get. So super exciting. As you know, I think skateboarding is awesome. I cannot do it, but these gentlemen here can, and I want to hear more about them, their journey, and really how they turned their passion into a career. Being a skateboarder, you not only have to know how to skateboard, but you also have to know the business of it. And so it's really entrepreneurship at its purest form. And so I'm really excited to bring to you these gentlemen.
I keep time more in my head than I do on a kit. And so I can just about tell where I'm at all the time. And so anytime I want to come back to the time, it's always on time. You know, I can come back to it, or I can leave it, or whatever I want to do with it. And that's the kind of thing that we have.
Thank you. What do you do? Yeah. I ain't kidding about nigga.
All the critics against you, but the streets love you. Let me show
you. You niggas want wordplay, but I'm about wordplay. First of the month, yeah, we call it birthday. This shit in the news, look at them fly. Look at them fly. You niggas want wordplay, but I'm about wordplay. Third of the month, yeah, we call it birthday. Look at them fly. Look at them fly. I'm way too intelligent to play with my intelligence. What you trying to tell me? What I'm saying is not relevant. Still represent, cause I'm a representer. Three bands, four, nine, beat. Young bounce right back like a rubber band. Water whip, look y'all, no one is. Stop this, stop this, where's your room? All this nonsense, there's no use. Married to the game, yeah, we just got a low. Game, yeah, we just got a low.
All right, so stuff I cannot do, clearly.
Did you guys like it?
What'd you guys think? Talent, athleticism. Awesome. So I want to address the pink elephant in the room. Does anyone know what it means to be an entrepreneur truly? Well, today we had an experiment in that this morning. Many of the original panelists are now in Detroit doing a national competition, and we were not aware. So this morning we had to scramble to get some replacements, and I think our replacements are even better. I'm going to open it up to Sheldon Lewis, if you want to raise your kind of... This is Sheldon.
Hello. It's good to see everybody. Thank you guys for coming out. Appreciate it.
He's a manager for the professional skaters. And Sheldon, you want to brief us on what happened this morning?
Well, wow. Where do I begin? Should I begin when I woke up this morning at 6 o'clock and I got a text message that said, hey, we're going to be going to Heartlines to skate Ryan Scheckler's event, if you didn't know. If you didn't know, and I should know because I'm the manager, right? And at that point, it was pretty crazy after that. But I want to thank the panelists that are here now. They're some great business minds, great skaters, and just all around great individuals that stepped up to, you know, to make sure that you guys had a great presentation today. But I have to be honest, that unfortunately is the nature of the business that I'm in, and you guys will find out as, I'm sure you guys, you know, are working while you're in school, you know, things don't go the way we plan, ever, you know, a saying that my mom used to always say to me, and it was, you want to hear God laugh, tell him you have a plan, and that is the truth. And so we're here. We hope you guys enjoy it. And again, thank you guys for showing up.
And now I'm going to go over to Spanish Mike. Hi, Spanish Mike. He is the team manager for Primitive Skateboarding. And the video we just saw was one of his promotional videos. So, Spanish Mike, tell me a little bit about your journey. How did you get where you are today? Where do you come from? And why do you love what you do so much?
How you doing, guys? I'm from Long Island, New York, originally. So I moved here like 6 years ago. I started skating when I was like 10, 11. Got a board for Christmas. My parents got me a board. And then just kept skating ever since. I didn't think it would bring me to where I'm at today, talking in front of all you guys about skateboarding. Because in school, a lot of the teachers, not saying anything bad, but a lot of teachers were like, what are you doing with skateboarding? That's not going to get you anywhere. Da, 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 da. But it's just like, I just followed my passion, and skateboarding was my passion. It's like any of you guys. I know you guys want to start a business. I see a lot of successful people in this room. So, but yeah, skateboarding has brought me to a lot of places. I've been to Beijing, South Africa, El Salvador. I've traveled the world because of skateboarding. The company I work for is Primitive Skate. You guys all may know of it. You see it in the stores, Tilly, Zoomies, everywhere. You guys probably heard of Paul Rodriguez. You guys raise your hands, Paul Rodriguez, yeah? All right, yeah. That's my boss. That's who I work for. So, yeah, he's someone I idolized growing up. And it's a dream come true to be here and to be able to speak with everybody. Yeah, skateboarding, it's definitely one of those things where it's like a hobby. It's like you guys make music. You guys probably write. There's probably poets in here. You know, it's just you guys are very passionate people. I'm a passionate person. So skateboarding was dearly to my heart. And when I had an opportunity to move out here, because I started filming first, so I had an opportunity from Manny, who was supposed to be here. He gave me opportunity to move to California and film professionally, you know. But that was because I started like a little web blog. I was like a little blogger. So I don't know, blogging's huge now. You guys probably know Gary Vee. Some of you guys probably listen to Gary Vee. Vaynerchuk, maybe? Yeah, all right, yeah.
And so, many of my students are also bloggers, so.
Yeah, so I just started a little web show, just, you know, showcasing how I lived. It was just, you know, regular life, just, you know, over and over again. And then Manny's professional, he saw that. One year I went to Tampa, they have this famous contest there. And I was like, let me do an episode with you. And then, like, we just instantly clicked. So then it was just like, oh, let me do an episode with so many different people. And then one day, I had a phone call. Was just like working. I used to work at a supermarket before. So I got a phone call from him because he used to skate for Famous Stars and Straps. I don't know if you guys ever heard of that. Travis Barker's company, maybe. Mm-hmm. So I got a phone call to work for them. And I always loved the brand and stuff. So I was just like, yeah, I packed my bags and I left. I told my parents, I was 20 years old. I'm 26 now. I was like, I'm leaving. They're like, what are you doing? Like, I'm like, I'm leaving. I have to go. If you guys don't let me go, I will never know. You know, it's like, you have to go and follow your dreams. Like, it really is true when they say that. Like, I'm like that one in a million story. Like, I just love skateboarding. I loved what I was doing. And it really took me to where I wanted to be. I feel like if you believe and are passionate about it, just because it's not in front of you, it doesn't mean it's not going to happen. You know, if you want $1 million, you will be able to get $1 million over time. But it's not just going to be like, oh, I want $1 million, it's going to pop up, like, you know.
Right. So. No, and I always tell my students, when you find something you love and you find a need in the marketplace that you can fulfill and then you find something you're good at, that's really your calling. That's what you should be doing.
It's
and I
true.
Think what your story just said is exactly that.
Yeah.
So thank you. Yo-Yo, I'm going to move on to you.
Hello.
So Yo-Yo, with that in mind, Yo-Yo is Young Money Lil Wayne. He's a skater. So it's all about passion. Tell me, how did you turn your passion into a moneymaker for you?
Well, when I was like 15, well, I'm from New Orleans, Louisiana. So when I was about 15, I met Lil Wayne at a skate park. And he's cousins with my best friend, Dante, who I was skating with at the time. And he used to tell Wayne, like, oh, yeah, my friend Yo-Yo, he skates, like, blah, blah, blah. Like, you should meet up with him. Like, he's really good. And he was like, okay, yeah, I want to see what this Yo-Yo kid's all about. So we met up at a skate park on Thanksgiving night in New Orleans. And yeah, ever since that day, it kind of, like, changed my life. He met me, and we skated. He fell in love with the way I skated. And then we just been homies ever since. So when I was about 16, he gave me an opportunity to go on tour with him because he was having ramps on stage. So he was like, you'll be able to get paid and you could be on tour with us. And I was like, I'm down. I was like, I'm down, like, let's do it. Unfortunately, I dropped out of school though because I wanted to pursue my passion and just go along with this calling that just was like, okay, like, yeah, just go for it. And my mom was very upset, but it all worked out in my favor and her favor at the end. So yeah, I went on tour at like 16, went on a TI 2 Chainz Wayne tour for about 3 months around the USA. Then after that, I went to Europe for about 2 months, traveled to Paris, Germany, Belgium, all kind of places, all around the USA. So yeah, I guess I just knew early on what I wanted to do. I started skating at like 11 years old, and even then I knew what I wanted to do. I was just like, yeah, this is it. Like, that's all I want to do every day. Like, I didn't really care about the money part or anything like that because I was just so in love with it. And, you know, the money just came along with it. Like, I got sponsorships from it and people to recognize me from skating and traveling. So I was just like, yeah, this is what it is. This is what I want to do.
Excellent. Thank you. Yeah. Christopher Scott, you're up next. He's a brand manager, market exec for C. Scott Group. Why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself, what your company does, and how you got to where you are?
Good morning, everyone. Actually, I think we're past lunchtime now. I'm probably the oldest person on this panel, and my skate heroes were Tony Hawk and Christian Hosoi. That's my generation. And I think for most of the up-and-coming skaters, they set the benchmark for professionalism. They were the rock stars of skateboarding, the very first rock stars. And that, in a nutshell, is how I became associated with skateboarding, is just be able to follow that. Skating in the streets was not as big as it is today. And so, you know, once you got out of your teens, hardly anybody ever skated. And that was the kind of the ebb and flow of the industry in the 90s. There was definitely a trough. And it came back with a vengeance. And I started working with Sheldon. We put together a group of people, and we had produced a radio show called All Action Sports Radio. We did that for 4 years, in which I acted as a brand manager and social media and marketing director. And that was my entry into the business side of the industry. And my background before that was design and the business side of design as a business. I didn't know a whole lot about skateboarding as a business. I knew it as a sport. And it was interesting to see how it had evolved beyond what I understood it to be. I had no idea that the brands were these multi-million dollar conglomerates. And being bought out, I think by the time I left All Action Sports Radio, Nike had purchased two or three of the top brands in the industry. And at the time, I was able to meet, I think we interviewed, what, every action sport athlete from snowboarding, skiing, skateboarding, motocross. The only person we didn't get to interview was Sean White, because he had an entourage 30 deep, and we just couldn't get through to him. But, you know, we had the opportunity to meet up with a lot of industry icons like Kelly Slater. Christian Hosoi actually came into studio. Incredibly generous of him. If you're into motocross, which I know a lot of people out here in the Valley, which is where I grew up out here, San Gabriel Valley, you know, motocross is considered an action sport, even though it is a motorsport. And that side pushed me more towards the branding. I mean, the opportunity that a lot of the sports, which all of you are learning in your business programs, and it's something that I would tell some of the younger guys coming up, is that not being an athlete doesn't mean that you can't be in the industry. I mean, the manufacturing side, the marketing side, the business aspect, the accounting. I mean, somebody has to write the checks, somebody has to do the posters, somebody has to design the shoes, which Tony's going to talk about in a minute. And that is where I kind of evolved my thinking as well, and I really started to follow more of the nuts and bolts of the financing of action sports. And I mean, that's kind of everything that I started with. And as I transitioned out of that, I never really left action sports on the consulting side. I do quite a bit of work still with Sheldon, and we're working on a project for Europe. We're working for a project here in the United States, and a lot of the consulting work that I started in action sports through, you know, the passion of some of these young guys have led me to some really interesting opportunities, where I've also been able to work with the relaunch of a 90s icon brand called Cross Colors. Most of you are probably too young to even know what that is. Some of you might. Clothing brand, music. And it's for on the marketing and branding side, it doesn't make a difference for me what the product is, and I learned that through the action sports entry, and that whether you're marketing an athlete or a product, the way that you position it to the demographic doesn't change, and that goes across the board for any product, and that's really what I learned from the action sports industry and entry into it.
Excellent, thank you. I just have one follow-up question, Christopher.
Yeah.
In your opinion, How big do you think the skateboarding industry could be as far as dollars?
Well, skateboarding is unique in sports in that, in my opinion, it's unique in that it's driven heavily by trends. A lot of the young athletes that come up set new benchmarks for what the trends will be, and the industry, as they get bought out by larger corporations, changes the ability of some of the more iconic names to move quickly enough into those new trends. And so that it's an industry that allows for a lot of new upstarts. And so what I would say to your specific question is that the opportunity is there for it to be as big as any other individual sport like golf or tennis. I mean, friends of mine that I've talked to about skateboarding, you know, they all kind of dismissed the idea of what skateboarding was as a business. But then I would see them 2 or 3 months later, and they're like, my God, I was downtown. I saw like 30 skateboarders on practically every corner. There were two skateboarders trying to do something. I mean, they didn't know how to describe what they were doing, but they saw them. And I think that that's kind of the wake-up that a lot of business managers, marketing managers, brand managers start to recognize when they're looking at opportunities to grow the demographic into a younger demographic, which allows for the growth of the industry to become a little bit more of a broader reach sport, even though, you know, a lot of the people in this room either have a skateboard, had a skateboard, or even still use a skateboard as transportation. It doesn't connect yet on the business side for the multinationals and the more household names. So I think that there's a huge opportunity, but again, it really is about the fact that the younger generation really propels the trend, and most companies cannot move fast enough to follow that trend.
Excellent. Sheldon, I think you had a remark you might want to make.
Yeah, I was hoping he would open with this because we talk about it every day. I'm sure we don't realize it, but every time we turn on our television, open up our tablet, get on our phone, and we see a B-roll of a commercial that runs, and now you're going to notice it because I'm pointing it out to you guys. Skateboarding is in almost, I would say, a good 80 to 85% of your commercials. Either a skateboard leaning on the wall, a kid skating by. If you remember the iPhone 7 when it dropped on Verizon, what did they use?
Skateboard?
A skater.
The whole commercial was a skater.
There's a reason for that. Because just like Christopher said, skateboard has connections to everyone in this room. Whether you have a sister, brother, cousin that skateboard. Did you skateboard as a kid? Did you laugh at a skater for falling? It's everywhere. And that's one of the reasons that we wanted to do this panel and work with you and you guys at this school is to kind of share what skateboarding truly is and the business behind it. Like Spanish Mike said here, it took him all around the world. You know, we want the generations and the generations to come to understand that skateboarding is a sport and a business sport, just like basketball, baseball, football. So that way, when you see your younger brother, younger cousin, younger sister, or whomever skateboarding, if they have a talent, encourage them, you know. And so from that point, I think the sky's the limit from the business standpoint because the marketing execs, they see it. Yep. They're using it. And now you guys are going to notice it. And you're going to be like, it was in all the commercials.
And then you're all going to start skating. Yes. Yo-yo.
Like, the thing about skating is really like an art form. I think that's why so many people attract to it because it is so individual. Like, you don't really need, like, a team or someone to coach you. There is no right or wrong way to skateboard. You just do it the best way you think is good for you, whatever is good for you on a board. You know, like somebody might like to go down rails or skate stairs, or someone just want to do like freestyle and cruise around, like there's no right or wrong way of doing it. That's why like people, so many people attract to it. And you know, I look at skateboarding more like an art than a sport, because sports kind of come with a lot of fundamentals and rules and regulations, and skateboarding don't really come with none of that. There's no rules, there's no regulations. It's whatever you want it to be, whatever you want to do. If you want to make a skateboard company about, I don't know, like vintage stuff, then you can do that. If you want to make a skateboarding company about cool music, rap stuff, then you can do that too. You know, so many different avenues. It isn't just this one avenue. It's like you could go into all different kind of things. You'd be an artsy skateboarder, a commercialized skateboarder, one that just does contests, or one that's just really just in the streets.
Excellent. Thank you. Tony. Tony Lozano, the creative director of Hex Brand on the End. Tell us a little bit about Hex Brand.
Well, Hex Brand is a bag company that was started by a couple brothers, Dan and Trent, who are still very involved on the product and marketing side. They started out with, the bulk of the business is an accessories business. It's hats. If you go into like a Macy's or to Bloomingdale's, the big derby hats, that's what we do. That's another part of our business. But for a long time, the brand or the company would pick up licenses for skate brands, and they would do Crooked. They would do you know, all the old school, you know, I'm drawing a blank on some of them, but a lot of the older ones, they would do the accessories for them, belts, watches, hats, bags. And from that experience, you know, a lot of that money was that we were making on that product would go back to the brand itself. So they had the idea of coming up with a company where it's our product, and you know, we can kind of capitalize on the market. So, you know, we started making bags, and that's how Hex was born. So the company is 22 years old, but Hex itself is about 5 years old.
Excellent. So tell me about your journey.
My journey. So I come from, I skated when I was younger, was never really good at it. So that's why I picked up other things. But I come from an accessories and a footwear background. I've worked for mom and pop companies where it was owned by husband and wife. And I worked for billion-dollar brands working on product. And, you know, from sales all the way up to merchandising and product development, I've kind of used every step along the way as a bit to add on my resume, and now I find myself at a smaller company, which is I love. You know, it's 5 minutes from home, and it's the thing that I like about doing what I do is because there's only, you know, six of us really that are the brand that make decisions on materials and shapes and, you know, styles and who we work with. So you know, it definitely is a little more fulfilling to work for a company like Hex.
What's interesting too is, in a small company, do you feel like your entrepreneurial spirit is fueled more than when you're at a big, large, billion-dollar company?
Absolutely. I mean, I took each of those experiences, and I tried to learn from every one. And you know, you pick up the small company, the husband and wife, like I watched what you know, how the product was being developed. And that's what kind of drove me to want to learn more about, you know, where we get these products made and where we're, you know, where we're selling at and how much, what our margin is and getting into the business side. And each step of the way, it was just, you know, okay, I feel like I can fully go to another brand and take this experience with me. And, you know, each step of the way is definitely you learn. And then from the larger companies, I've learned structure of how, you know, the pecking order and how things are put out from concept to market.
Excellent. What I'm really hearing from you guys is that you have a passion, whether it's the physical art of skateboarding that you're good at, or some tangential arm related to skateboarding, like the marketing or product creation. So tell me, how do you allow, when it gets rough, I mean, inevitably you're going to have a rough time, maybe the business isn't doing so well, how do you carry on? And I'll just leave this open for anyone.
Well, I think I think the solution to that is you just keep moving. I mean, you can't. There's always going to be an ebb and flow in the market and what consumers are into. You just got to keep pushing. And I mean, you know, it's if you give up on that idea that, you know, or the market's not hitting, you got to find other avenues to keep. You know, you got to continue to hunt and find that business. And whether it's, you know, you change up and do something, you know, something else, you just got to keep moving.
I'm elaborate on that. Also, too, with social media, I'm pretty sure 100% of this room has Instagram, right? Snapchat? Yeah, exactly.
Not Facebook, though. Not Facebook. I've already established
that. Not Facebook?
That.
No.
My students don't do Facebook, apparently.
Start a fan page today. No, honestly, like, think about it. Half of us, we buy stuff online. Some of us may go to the store to see a t-shirt. Some of us may just be like instant purchase. So I feel like moving forward in that sense of a business standpoint is like if something bad happens, you just kind of just pick up the pieces and keep going. You know, you honestly just take the energy you started with and just never stop.
Excellent.
And also, it's good. And from a business sense, surround yourself with the right group of people. You're only as good as the people standing next to you. Similar to the guys that I'm sitting next to now. They showed up for me when I needed them. And it's the same thing in business. You want to make sure that, because there's no, whenever someone says, oh, I did it myself, it's not true. No one can do anything by themselves. You got to have a good team of people to really accomplish your goal, because at the end of the day, we're not perfect. There's things that I feel that I'm good at, but you know, I lean on Christopher to help me in areas that I'm not as strong. You know, and it's the same thing about what Spanish said about Manny calling him up to come out to LA. Manny knew that he had a talent, but he knew that it had to be shown in the right manner. And after meeting Mike, he knew that Mike was the guy to help showcase his talent to the world. And what they put together, you know, is in skateboarding is really legendary. He, like you said, he started from a blog to Spanish Mike TV to helping out Manny at Famous Stars and Straps to ultimately becoming one of the top, would you say team manager? What was your team managers of one of the hottest skateboard apparel brands in the world? You know, like he said, Paul Rodriguez is his boss. Like, to come from where he came from is amazing. And that story can only be told by the people that he surrounded himself with to get him to that area. So when times were tough, and I'm sure Mike can share some tough times, I know I got a few stories, but it was him being able to lean on his team to, you know, to fulfill, you know, his dream. And my man, 100 grand has now showed up.
Rule number one, be on time.
Yes.
Everybody put your hands together for Mr. Sticks.
Oh, I'm supposed to introduce myself. Hi, I'm a student here, and no, I'm just playing. My name is Sticks. I am from Watts, California, ladies and gentlemen. I am proud to be here to share whatever I need to share, my story, my motivation, my experience with you to help ensure that you take your careers and your life to the next level. I get a 30-minute grace period because we live in L.A. and traffic is everywhere, so don't hold it against me.
Don't tell my students that, Sticks.
Listen to your teachers. Sorry, professors. Should I just go?
Yeah.
Yeah, you know what, Sticks? Let me give you a question to kind of guide you.
I was about to go in.
Sticks is a rapper entertainer from Watts, as you know. So, Sticks, tell us a little bit about your background, your journey, and why you're doing what you do and how you keep going.
Wow.
Loaded question.
Well, growing up, I'm not sure if it... Show of hands, who know what Watts is or where Watts is? That's cool. Like it. For those of you who don't know, Watts is about, it's in South Central, but the east side of South Central Los Angeles, right next to Compton. You know, Long Beach is on the east side of that. But Watts is kind of that area that kind of gets overlooked. How many people heard of the Watts riots? Yeah. 1965, legendary riots, blah, blah, blah. I use all that to get back, to digress back to my story. It's a lot of energy in that area. And Watts stands for We Are Taught to Survive. And coming from that area forces you to do two things. Either do what it is that you see is going on, which could be negative or malicious or malignant, and could spread to other people that you may know or relationships that you have. Or you can take that energy, take those experiences, and turn it into something positive. I grew up in Watts. I lived in Watts till I was like 24 years old. I'm 22 years old now. I'm not going to tell you my real age. I'm a rapper. I got to lie about these things. But I grew up in Watts till I was 24 years old. And obviously, I don't mean to bring it down, but I need to break it down to build it back up, my story. Lots of friends and family who were murdered, who were killed. The first thing my stepfather ever taught me how to do was cook cocaine. He didn't tell me, hey, son, you want to learn how to shoot this basketball? He was like, hey, I don't know how to start a conversation with you, but want to cook some crack? Anyhow, I just say those things to let you know the type of environment that I was living in. But I took all of that and I said, you know what? My cousin didn't get the right end of the stick. My friend is only 16 years old and he's going to jail for life. You know, my mother and my sisters and all these people are getting abused or whatever you want to have it. So I took all of that energy and I manifested it into the thought process of, I'm going to do something better than this. I'm going to take whatever passion or idea I have and turn that into something positive. So the first thing that I did was I was a part of the creation of a dance craze called crump dancing. I'm proud and not proud of that at the same time. But it was a way for us to express that energy, for us to get that out living in Watts and Compton. A lot of us were gang members. We were all in gangs. But instead of doing what quote-unquote gang members do with guns and drugs and all that, we said, let's just pull this family environment together and use our frustration out on dance. So dance started in Watts and Compton, and now it's a worldwide craze, and there's a movie about it and documentaries and different things, and you may see people express their dance styles and have no idea where it comes from or who created it, which I don't care anymore. I'm just happy that it's out there and it's changing kids' life. But it was a way for us as children to stay off of the streets and to do something positive. So from there, after the whole crump craze went crazy and did good, I was like, I want to rap. Just like that, literally. I was like, I want to rap. A few friends of mine, bless you. were rapping or whatever, so I say I wanted to do that. And then it's just something that came natural. And I always said from that day, that I was going to wear Watts on my back. If you see my jacket, I got a big Watts tower on it. I was going to wear Watts on my back and think of something to uplift people who not only come from here, but who live in the same type of environment. It doesn't matter what race you are. All of us experience struggle of some sort. And my story is to take the struggle, break it in half, crumble it into pieces, and build a new story back up. That's my whole motivation. And if it wasn't from where I come from, it wouldn't have allowed me to develop that mentality. So you got two options. Remember this. And I call this Think Watts. Because when you think Watts, you think of electricity. But when you think of electricity, there's a light bulb. But if you have a light bulb, that means you have an idea. And if you have an idea, you can change the world. So think Watts. That was my Martin Luther King for the day.
And with that, Styx has arrived. Okay, so here, I have another question to pose to all of you. What has been your favorite passion project that you have done to date? And whoever wants to go ahead.
Wow. I guess I'll go first. I'm going to say this. It's another one of those. I'm excited that I did it, and I hate that I did it because it's terrible for rap music, but it's great for me. I developed, I guess you could say, discovered and produced, wrote, whatever you want to call it, Iggy Azalea. Now y'all get what I'm saying. it was a girl who from Australia, the lowest crime rate in the world, come to a studio on Slauson and Crenshaw saying, I want to make rap music. And me and my partner was like, yeah, sure. This is terrible. And next thing you know, the first song we did, for those who are familiar with Iggy Azalea, it blew up. Hey, thanks rap music. And that was it. Iggy Azalea is born. That was my favorite.
Wow. Very cool. Christopher?
Well, I think probably the most satisfying thing that I ever did was what I started the conversation and explaining where I came from in this business was developing and creating the All Action Sports Radio Show. One, because on the creative side, it didn't exist, so I didn't go into a company. I had to create it from scratch with my partners. On the creative side, it was incredibly rewarding. On the side of the entertainment of it, we were able to get access to people that would have never given us the time of day for any other reason other than the fact that we had a little card that said press. That was it. We walked right up to them. We talked to them about whatever we wanted to ask them, and they would actually answer our questions. And that was interesting. It was a really fun experience, and it really allowed me to recognize the diversity of skill sets that I had within myself that I didn't know. I was very focused on the design side of brand management, and after having to do essentially a startup company, I could take those experience to, as Tony said, I could take those experience to any big corporation and feel completely at ease to know I knew what I was talking about when I interjected into a conversation at any level. And so I would say that that's probably the most satisfying thing that I ever did.
Excellent. Tony, I'm going to throw the question to you.
Yes. Passion project. I mean, I think for the most part, design has been a passion project of mine, and it's been something that has obviously opened doors to companies that I've worked for that, you know, looking at somebody's resume, they have all the schooling and all the, you know, the right things on their resume, but they don't know design, or they don't know Illustrator, they don't know Photoshop. So having that in my skill set has always been something that got me in the door. And you know, when it's unfortunate that I'm not working, or you know, I have that to fall back on, and I could do that, you know, from my office at home, and it's all about building relationships and keeping those contacts open, and you know, things always manage to work out.
Awesome. Sheldon, I know you want to say something.
Hi. It's me again. No. Probably it would be the argument that I had with this man next to me about doing what I do now. Because, as Mike mentioned, I work with a good skater, friend of his, Manny Santiago, which is was my very first client. And I'll never forget, we were having lunch with my younger brother and Manny, and Manny was complaining that he needed help with, you know, his sponsors and trying to get new people to help him out. And my brother, you know, opened his mouth, was like, oh, ask Sheldon, he knows how to do it. And I'm like, what are you doing, man? You're messing with my friendship. Like, he's going to think I'm just hustling him just to be his manager. And so he was like, yeah, I want you to help me out. I was thinking about asking you. And I was like, well, I got to think about it. And this guy next to me, I call him up and I'm like, hey, Manny just asked me to be his manager. I don't think I'm going to do it. and he screamed at me, use all the curse words you could probably think of. And just told me, it's like, you'd be stupid if you didn't take the opportunity. He's like, because you can do it, I believe in you. And so I did, and here we are. Now I get to talk to you guys about skateboarding and business.
Excellent. All right. Who wants to take this one? Where do you see yourself in 10 years?
That's easy.
Loaded question.
Top of the world.
On top of the world. I like it.
There you go.
Oh, again? Awesome. Rule number two, never be afraid to talk. This is your time to shine. I'm going to write a little quote book.
Well, you have to catch up. You have to catch up. Six.
I know. So I have a lot to say. I'm excited. In 10 years, I would like to see myself, and I'm dead serious. It's going to sound funny, but I'm dead serious. Watch, it's going to happen. I'm going to have about 10 life insurance policies, about 5 trust funds. I want to be worth, hopefully my net worth is the same, but I just want to gross at least $1 billion in the next 4 years. And on the path that I'm going, God willing, I continue. But in 10 years, I want to be one of the most prominent figures in entertainment. I want to be one of the biggest motivational speakers, have the best music, be one of the biggest leaders that we've never seen, because I think what's missing in music, and I don't want to say it's missing like everyone sucks, but everyone is great at what they do, but as entertainers, we have so much influence. As business professionals and CEOs, we have so much power to change lives. Like, you literally can turn someone's frown upside down, as elementary as that quote is. And I want to use that power. Like, I want to teach people about finance. I want people, especially people from where I come from, I don't think my mother even knows how to save money properly. She didn't even have a life insurance plan. She's 68 years old, and we just situated that kind of stuff. Like, you know how many people from areas like Watts, Compton, Long Beach, Inglewood, Linwood, Lawndale, Glendale, whatever, Dale, Angeles, whatever, don't know anything about wealth or finance or how to build it? You guys, I appreciate and I envy you so much, because I went to college for 5 years and still don't have my degree. I went to like 2 junior colleges and Cal State for like half of a semester and still didn't get my degree. So I really strongly encourage every single person in these seats who are here. I appreciate you that are encouraging the students to do it. People who are the faculty, the staff, even you right there holding that camera. I appreciate y'all, because this is where it starts, to get the information. You have to start here. Take this and change somebody else's life. After you change yours, make sure that you, before you go under the grave, because remember, we can't take nothing with us, at least you can take the thought that you helped somebody's life get better. And I want to use this 10 years from now. What I'm doing right now, I hope 10 years from now will change the world.
I think I have time for one more panel question, and then we're going to throw it out to you guys. So think of your questions. My last panel question, we're just going to go down the line if we can. Words of advice for the students out there.
Do what makes you happy.
Excellent.
Absolutely. Stay passionate at all times. When it gets tough, just know that there's better days ahead.
Take advantage of every opportunity given to you.
Make relationships. Relationships are the most important thing in business. Remember that. Relationships are key.
Stay
When I've had interns work for me, I've always told them this one idiom, and which helped me when I was an intern, which I had to learn firsthand, which is, don't be a money taker, be a money maker. And what I mean by that is, if you're going to go work for somebody, for instance, any of these skateboarders that are out there, they have relationships, as Sticks just said. If those relationships in some way, and you can connect the dots to the companies that you work with to bring in sponsorships, to bring in an opportunity to do a product, to enhance the business in which you are working, you are building for yourself a position that doesn't exist because nobody else has the relationships that you have. And so by bringing in opportunities, your potential employers, if you're an intern or if it's your very first job, they will see you as somebody who can enhance and build their business rather than just being there to collect a paycheck.
Excellent.
I think along the lines of what everybody else said is just remain humble. Always keep yourself open to learning. Some of the most important things that I do on a day-to-day basis, I learned because I was willing to, open up and be a student. And, obviously you guys are all on the right track. You never stop being a student after you graduate. You always are learning and you're always, trying to pick up that extra little bit of skill set. So be humble.
Excellent. Thank you.
Thank you, Kendrick.
Okay, so does anyone have any questions? Oh, lots of them. Cool. Raphael, you want to pass the... Sunny. There you are. Thank you.
I saw your hand up first. Go ahead.
I had a question. This sticks, right? Do you have any mixtapes or albums coming out?
Absolutely. Shameless plug time. My Instagram, Twitter, SoundCloud, and everything is WattStixx, WattStixx. And then it's on Spotify, Apple Music, Tidal. Few new things. Don't listen to the old stuff. That's the old me. But that's how I take care of my kids, though, is streaming. They don't pay us a lot, but they give us something. But yeah. WattStixx, WattStixx. It should come up.
Why don't you tell them what you just got through doing? Tell them what you just got through doing. Your big tour that you just finished.
Oh, I was on tour with Snoop Dogg. I did like 16 dates with Snoop. And I'm about to leave again and go on tour with Wyclef.
And Carnival 3.
Yeah, Carnival 3 coming soon. I'm on his album too. Thank God. Be humble.
Okay, so first I'll come right back to you. You guys want to help me out?
Hello, everybody. I'm just curious, how do you guys differ from all the competitors, and how do people choose your product over other people's products?
Well, I'll start that off with... on the branding side, I guess just a show of hands, how many of you are focused strictly on the marketing branding side of the business? And how many of you are familiar with the works of Al Reiss? Okay. Al Reiss wrote a book with, I can't remember his partner, his writing partner, the last name is Trout, but Al Reiss is on LinkedIn, he does a lot of posts, and he wrote a book called Positioning. I think it is a seminal work. It's incredibly iconic. It speaks specifically to the ability of people to only hold up to four brands in any one category. It doesn't matter what the category is. If you think for yourself, any product, whether it be laundry detergent or a clothing brand, toothpaste, anything, you're not going to probably be able to think of more than three or four, maybe five if you really know the marketplace. And so in that respect, the brand side is really about the differentiating the specifics, such as I think in positioning, he talked about the idea of beers. There was the king of beers, Budweiser. Then there was Heineken, which was the number one imported beer. And what he talked about was that when you try to line extend, meaning if you're the king of beers, you can't be the import beer champion, nor can you be the light beer champion. There's already somebody else in the marketplace who's number one in that category. So with any products that you're developing, the niche, it doesn't matter how small that niche is, it's incredibly important that you attain the number one position in that niche.
Hi, everybody. I have a quick question. How do each of you define success, whether it's personal growth or growth in a business? Do you think about lifelong customers, your swath of the market share? What matters to you most when you define success?
For me, and I think this is kind of it's very general, because everyone's personal success is their own. And I will say this, don't measure yourself next to other people. You have to find what your benchmark is and break through that. But at the end of the day, if you can wake up, and I always tell people this all the time, I look around my room every morning when I wake up and I'm like, man, I do this for a living every day. And it puts a smile on my face. So if you can do that and wake up with a smile on your face for whatever business that you're in, then guess what? You're successful.
Hi. Thank you for being here. I'm a musician and a composer, and I did skate when I was young. And I think, thinking right now, seeing you guys, I think that's why, or a major part of my life, why I changed to music, because I was skating and I thought of all these connections about music with skateboarding, right? It was really hand to hand. And now I'm interested in knowing how is the business of really making music and skateboarding together, like the business part of it. How does it work?
Yeah, Hobson.
Yeah, he's a good friend of mine. He started skateboarding. He's super good at skating, but like knew that skateboarding wouldn't take him to the next level, so he picked up music. And now his music is so successful that he's friends with all the big no-name skaters because they know of him. So he actually went to school with Paul Rodriguez as well. So, but yeah, it's go hand in hand, to be honest. Like, if you look at it, a lot of rappers dress like skaters, or, you know, vice versa. Skaters want to be rappers. So it just goes hand in hand. We use their music all day long. So, I mean, I don't know if I answered. Did I answer the question right? Did I give you? I feel like I just started rambling. Sorry.
I mean, it was like rappers went to skating, right? And then that's why rap is more associated with skating right now.
Yeah.
But in my time, it was more like punk rock.
Yeah.
Why did it change? Why did that
change? I think just the timing is different. It's a different day and age. And
yeah.
As people get into more things and get into other stuff, then so is skateboarding and rap music and punk rock and all that stuff. Because if you look at a person like Lil Uzi, who is totally into punk rock and rock music, but he is a rapper who also skates.
To answer your question, though, Travis Barker, who's well-renowned, famous drummer, he grew up skateboarding, too. So, I mean, his music is big, too, as well. So it's just different. There are skateboarders who listen to punk rock music. It's not just all hip hop. It's honestly every genre of music, you know. Definitely a lot of different genres for sure. I think the switch now, just because I guess hip hop is so huge, you know. It's just a different market. I feel like I still listen to punk rock. I still listen to different Boxcar Racer. I still listen to Angel of the Airwaves. Like, I listen to a lot of different music. So, I mean, even Yo-Yo could say that too. He doesn't just listen to hip hop. We all listen to everything.
I think a lot of people can't really like afford like instruments or like guitars or drums or like that. So they just pick up a pen and pad and just start rhyming.
And then skate after you get done.
Yeah. So, yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah, the skateboarding side and as Yo-Yo said, the skateboarding is a very low barrier of entry, both on the athlete side and on the business side, because it doesn't take a whole lot to get into skateboarding. You don't have to join a league. You don't have to have a bunch of equipment. You can get a ratty skateboard from Target or Kmart to start off when you're 8 years old. And then, you know, as you get older, then, you know, you step it up, go to a skate shop, spend, you know, $180 on a nice set.
And lastly, just to add to what they're saying, it's synonymous, because the people who do it and do both come from the same environment. A lot of times they all grow up with each other, or we come from the same cities, or we just experience the same type of experiences. So you just inclined to do both. I got a skateboard before I got a basketball when I was growing up. Do I know how to skate now? No. But I have one, and Sheldon keeps throwing skateboards in my trunk. So I just think the world's, and I think now with sports, action sports, music, barriers are now being broken. Because you skate don't mean you have to listen to a certain music. I think now everybody as a people are now just like, I love to skate and I love to listen to hip hop. And we're starting to see a lot of that more. And I think that's kind of why it's synonymous. There's no real answer why it happens. It's just the way it is.
Skateboarding and music is two, like, individual things. It's all about self.
Yep.
So they just easily go with each other, because, like I said, ain't no right or wrong way to skate. Ain't no right or wrong way to sing or rap or make music. So you just do it however you want to. So that's how they just automatically click.
Yeah. Oh,
excellent. Thank you, guys. Our time is up. But before everyone takes off, because I know some of them have a class at 1:40, I want you guys to have the opportunity to give us your Instagram handle or whatever else, your social media site or website. Styx already did that. But Yo-Yo, if you want to give a start, and you can kind of go down the line.
I only use Instagram and Twitter, and they're both Yosef Ratliff, Yosef Ratliff. Yes, that's my real name, by the way.
Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Spanish Mike TV across the board. So I started early on when it came to social media. I made sure I had all my handles with no underscore numbers or XOXO on there. So.
Following me would probably be really boring, but it's Lewis Brand LLC for my Instagram.
Following me, you have to give a dollar donation for every. No, I'm just playing. Wattstix, WATTSSTIX. That's everything.
I don't really use social media for business. You can.
Okay,
I have a lot
Tony,
of it for
your LinkedIn. Tony. Go ahead.
But you can go to my LinkedIn. It's Christopher Scott and C Scott Consulting Group, and everything's up there, and you can reach me there.
And for us, Hex Brand, HexBrand.com. That's our social media handles as well. Hex Brand.
Well, they will be here answering questions. So if you guys want to stick around and ask them more questions, by all means do so.
Thanks,
thank
guys.
You guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.